The Stone of Jacob, i.e. Jacob's pillow. The Stone of Destiny appears in the book of Genesis as a stone used as a pillow by the Israelite patriarch Jacob. Jacob, at the place later called Bethel, had a vision in his sleep. In this vision, he saw God and the angels going up and down a ladder and stairs leading to heaven. In the morning, he set his pillow as a pillar and consecrated it with an anointment of oil. Jacob's son later carried the stone to Egypt and on to Spain with King Gathelios. Around 700 BC, it appears in Ireland, placed upon the sacred hill of Tara, the Fail, the fated stone, or the Stone of Destiny, was used to coronate the kings of Ireland. Fergus Moore, the founder of Dalry Arta, being of royal blood of Ireland, he had the stone brought to the west coast of Scotland to be crowned upon it and unite the people. Kenneth MacAlpine finally moved the stone to the monastery at Scone. The last Scottish king to be crowned on the stone was John Baliol in 1292. In 1296, after the Scots were defeated at the Battle of Dunbar, Edward I Longshanks went to Scone Abbey to take the Stone of Destiny back to England to prevent any further Scots being crowned upon it. The monks, hearing he was on his way, hid the stone reputedly in Dunzina Hill, replacing the stone, which the English had never seen before, with a sewer drain cover. Here it remained hidden until sometime around 1795 to 1820. A modern description of the stone is a pink sandstone rectangle of dimensions 66 centimetres by 42 centimetres by 26.7 centimetres and a weight of 152 kilograms. It has a figure of 8 iron loops at either end. This is the one you will see for the coronation. Several other replica stones are placed around Scotland, such as the one outside Scone Abbey. Geologists have tested the coronation stone to confirm it is from Scone Quarry. If the stone was bought from Israel, like in the Jacob story, it would be made from a limestone or dolomite type of rock, typical for the geology in that area. Historical descriptions recall it being of a dark metallic looking rock, not pink sandstone. None of the modern stones can be the real Stone of Destiny.
Edward I, King of England, Longshanks. If your viewers have seen the film Braveheart, that's who we're talking about, the King of England. Defeated the Scots at Bannockburn, and he took the stone from Scone and took it to Westminster. He had a wooden chair built to house the stone.
Okay. 1296.
Bannockburn. I thought as Scots won that one with a resounding victory. The stone was removed in 1296. The Battle of Bannockburn was 1314, 18 years after, and 9 years after the murder of William Wallace.
So, the next question, where's the real stone?
It's still in Scotland, and it was still being hidden by people from this who are Scottish nationalists. I won't say from the Scottish Nationalist Party, but people who
Scottish
are
Scottish nationalists.
Yeah, they've been holding on to it all this time, mm-hmm. In order to bring it out when they get independence.
Right.
And
gatekeepers, one and all. So where is the real stone? It is not Scottish nationalists or patriots who have it hidden. It is the journeymen masons of Lodge Number 8.
There was talk as early as 1818 to build a memorial to William Wallace. In 1850 saw the rise of a movement to build a monument to William Wallace, headed up by Reverend Charles Rogers. In 1856, he commissioned a competition to design the monument and started fundraising from the public, as the monument was too controversial for government funding. Abbey Craig was settled on as a location for the monument due to this being the area which Wallace was thought to have rallied his men before the Battle of Stirling Bridge in 1297, and also it being the geographical heart of Scotland. In 1859, John Thomas Roachhead, an architect from Glasgow, won the competition to design the monument from a total of 106 entries. He also at this time held the position of Grand Architect of the Provincial Grand Lodge of Glasgow. Roachhead never received his fee due to the budget going over, which resulted in financial problems and eventually a mental breakdown in 1869, the year the monument opened, and which he never recovered from until his eventual death in 1878. On June the 24th, 1861, on the anniversary of the Battle of Bannockburn, the laying of the foundation stone commenced. For the simple laying of a foundation stone for a controversial monument, the event was on an unprecedented grand scale. A procession from Stirling to the monument at Abbey Craig included representatives from all the Masonic lodges and clan chiefs with their respective swords. 30 companies of volunteer soldiers representing many regiments there with a permission granted by the Commander-in-Chief. Magistrates from the town councils of Scotland, 40 bands, the Order in Odd Fellows and the Crispins and others. The Master Gunner of Dumbarton Castle with a William Wallace sword. A servant of the Earl of Elgin carrying the sword of King Robert the Bruce, and the sword of Black Douglas was sent by William Campbell. The 7 incorporated trades bearing the ancient blue blanket, as well as members of the ancient order and society of Omnium Gatherum. The procession stretched for 2 miles. A conservative agreed count of people in attendance and public has been set at between 80 and 100,000 people. At the summit of the Abbey Craig, the most worshipful Grand Master, the 6th Duke of Atholl, along with John Tate Esquire, Sheriff of the County of Clackmannan, watched the blessing given by Reverend Dr. Arnott, Grand Chaplain of Edinburgh. The stone was lowered together with an Edinburgh crystal vase, time capsule, containing books about Wallace, the complete works of Burns, a Masonic calendar, designs for the monument and inscriptions on vellum, also coins of gold, silver and bronze, and a New Testament. A quote from the Stirling Observer says, "No such gathering of Scotsmen has ever taken place with the memory of living men." By contrast, the opening of the monument on Saturday, September the 11th, 1869, was a very low-key affair, taking only 30 minutes, with almost 100 gentlemen present. What brought me to consider the Stone of Destiny and the Wallace Foundation Stone are the same? I went to view the plans at the archives in Stirling Library. J.T. Roachford's original submission was of a tower only. It did not include the crown structure we see today. It had a simple battlement configuration with a parapet, crenelles and merlons. Also, a gatekeeper's lodge was added to the plans. You can see from the plans they indicate a staircase going down from the ground level in the gatekeeper's cottage. The original submission did not include a foundation level. Visiting the monument and asking the staff in the tower to show me the foundation stone, and I was sent outside the tower to a stone halfway up the wall, then to a stone in the wall behind the ticket counter. Finally, they admitted they did not know where it was. The importance of a procession for the foundation stone Besides it being such a large event, can be seen in the displaying of the blue blanket. Many stories of the origin exist in Masonic history. The first dates back to the First Crusades in 1096 to 1099. The banner was called the Banner of the Holy Ghost, and those under it, the Knights of the Holy Ghost. They hoped to pin it to the walls of Jerusalem. The Lodge of Journeymen Masons number 8 had the right to carry the blue blanket. A modern origin is it was presented by King James III in 1482 and was carried at Flodden in 1513. It has only been carried for 4 foundation stones. 1, the Grand Lodge Hall. 2, the Wallace Monument. And 3, the Royal Infirmary. And 4, the 6th Duke of Atholl Memorial Loggery. So now I've presented my evidence and ideas, there is more to discover, and I will continue my search. The future offers unlimited possibilities, and I'm excited to explore them.
Rien qui approchait ta beauté.
What does that mean?
I did not come to these answers or these revelations without my partner every step of the way, without whose contributions this would never have been possible. For every great man, there is a great woman beside him.